storyteller Fitz Edwards was at a party once, and someone told him a story that was not amusing. He vowed that day to only tell stories that are amusing. This is Amusing Stories with Fitz Edwards.
Oh, I like that name. Everybody, welcome to another episode of Musing Stories with Fitz Edwards. I'm your host, Fitz Edwards. And as always, we've got Nate Anderson playing the keyboards over there. How are you, Nate?
Hello. I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing well. I really like what you're playing tonight. You've got a good vibe going. I don't know what this is. I'm not sure it's going to go with this story yet, but you know, it's going to take us there. It's a good intro. And of course, we got Simon over here as well.
Hey, Fitz.
How you doing, Simon?
I got to tell you, I could have gone either way, and then I started hearing this beautiful music, and it made me happy. And so right now, I'm feeling pretty happy about the world.
That's terrific. Well, you know, we're going to try to bring some joy and happiness to everybody with this podcast today. And for those who are just tuning in for the first time, this podcast is about funny, interesting, silly, shocking, sometimes even heartwarming tales from my life and the lives of my friends and family. And the way we do it is we're doing this live. Nate is playing live musical accompaniment to the stories.
It's incredible.
Yeah, this isn't done like afterwards in post. This is all live. And, you know, sometimes, you know, I send the stories out kind of like a blueprint of the stories ahead of time. So he's got an idea of what's going on, but he's really just, he's doing this, you know, it's improv, improvisation, if you don't.
Yeah. That's like a silent movie, like in the old days.
Yeah. And so also, you know, the names of the people in these stories, they've been changed for various reasons, but they will remain consistent through all the stories of this podcast, right? So for instance, we have a guy named Dave Mumfries. That's not his real name. In one of the stories, in this story tonight, but if he appears in another podcast story, that name will remain consistent. Do you get that?
I think so.
Okay. And that's just because people love the first and last names from the stories over the years. Yeah. So that's it. All right. Let's set the story. Set the time frame of the story that's going to be told tonight. The title of the story is The Story of Halloween Dress-Up Day. And this story occurs, I looked it up, actually on October 30th, 1987, which was also my birthday.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. And so what we'd like to do is provide some historical context for the story so people out there know what was going on in the world, right? Simon, do you have something that was going on in the world?
Well, I remember 1987. That year started, of course, with the New York Giants winning the Super Bowl, the great 86 Giants. But of course, the Super Bowl itself was in 1987. So that year started off great for me. And it ended with the great stock market crash of 1987, which would have been in October. It would have been just a couple weeks before this story. And I sort of remember it, but I was in high school, so it really didn't affect me at all.
Well, other things that were going on out in the world were the first episode of The Simpsons aired in 1987 on the Tracy Ullman Show.
that's what Nate gives you right there. How good was that?
Yeah.
Did you notice that?
I did. That was a nice little touch there, Nate. Thank you for that. Other things were happening out in the world. At the movie theater, you had Platoon. That won Best Picture that year in 87. So there's something. Good movie. Kind of terrifying, horrifying.
Great
but,
movie.
Yeah, great movie. On the charts. And of course, you know, now Nate can't play these songs because of copyright issues sometimes, but Walk Like an Egyptian by the Bangles was on the charts in 87. And also, being from New Jersey, very proud of this, Living on a Prayer, Bon Jovi, also 87. Yeah. So there you go. Some things that were happening in 1987. Yeah. All right, let's get down to it. So October 30th, 1987.
I got to tell you, I'm on the edge of my seat here, Fitz. Because,
well, thank you.
I mean, obviously Halloween, the whole point of Halloween is dress up. And yet there's something that makes this method of dressing up unique.
Yeah.
Well, how is this different from any other Halloween? I can't wait to hear this.
Anybody who knows me knows that I love Halloween. My birthday being the day before Halloween is, you know, that obviously adds to it. But it's a great birthday. If I had to pick my birthday over again, I would pick October 30th because you get all the benefits of Halloween, but Halloween doesn't steal your birthday, doesn't steal your thunder. Everybody was up for the partying. If I'm a little kid, everybody wanted to come to my Halloween party because you could dress up in costumes. It's super fun holiday. You know, I'm kind of a fun, creative guy, you know? So it just fits, you know? And it's also, in New Jersey, we called it Mischief Night, October 30th. And that was the night you went out with toilet paper and eggs and you just fucked up the neighborhood.
I did not know that.
Yeah, Mischief Night. Totally fun night. So yeah, love my birthday to this day, yeah. So here's what happens. This is the story of dress up day, Halloween dress up day. In my high school in Summit, New Jersey, they had this thing and you could dress up in costume and go to school. Now, October 30th, 1987 was a Friday. So that's why we did it on the Friday. If it was, Halloween was on a Tuesday, you would do it on the day of Halloween. I don't know if that really matters. But that's what was going on. You dress up in your costume. You go to high school. Awards are given. Super fun day, right? So that's what's going on. Now, I was at the time interested, as I am now, in microphones and broadcasting. And I had gone in, and the vice principal in charge of discipline at Summit High School, we're going to call him Mr. Evans, for this story. He had been reading the morning announcements over the loudspeaker for many, many years. I wanted to get into broadcast journalism, so I had this whole thing prepared. I went down to his office, and I it was before PowerPoint, so I didn't have a PowerPoint. I would like to, once a week, be able to read some of the morning announcements, because one day I would like to be a broadcast journalist. And then he stopped me right there. He's Peter, are you saying you want to read the morning announcements? Yeah, you can start tomorrow. So it turns out he didn't want to do it anymore. He'd been doing it for years. So I got the job. And so my costume in 87 was a gorilla. My mom is an incredible seamstress. She would make custom Halloween costumes for my entire family. And what she did is we went down to Fabricland on Route 22 and we bought some thick black fur material, fabric, and she measured me, and there was a pattern, and she made me a custom gorilla outfit. The only thing that wasn't part of the outfit was we bought a mask, because she couldn't, like, fabricate plastic at this point. So we had a gorilla mask, and then I had everything. I had, like, you know, hands and feet, and it was an incredible costume. And as you know, one of the fun things about Halloween costume is if you can conceal your identity, right?
Totally.
Yeah. Yeah, so that was fun. Nobody knew who I was. I'm a gorilla. I'm walking around the high school. It's fun.
You could throw feces at people and they would have no idea.
Yeah, yeah. So to give you a little background on Mr. Evans, he was a family friend. He's going to appear in other podcast stories, by the way. It's a family friend I'd known in my entire life. He'd come over to my house. He's friends with my mom and dad, and he had a great sense of humor. But in the school system, he had this job of vice principal in charge of discipline. So he really had to be a dick to a lot of people. I had a lot of friends that were in detention, and they all disliked him because he was giving them detention. And, you know, you can't be, you know, everybody's friend when you're doing that. Otherwise, you got no, you know, you can't dish out the discipline. So that was kind of his background, but I knew that he was a really funny guy inside. He's kind of trapped in this job. He loved his job. He's really good at it, but he wanted to do funny things, I thought. So I'm reading the announcements. I got my gorilla outfit. The mask is off, and he comes in, and I don't do a lot of impressions, but this is exactly what Mr. Evans sounded like. And he's like, Mr. Fitz, can I borrow that monkey outfit for about 10 minutes? Like, well, first of all, it's not a monkey outfit. It is a gorilla outfit, Mr. Evans. And I was like, well, yeah, I mean, but I got to go to class after this. He's like, you know, I'll rate you a pass and you can go late to homeroom. And when you're done reading the announcements, why don't you meet me down to the custodian's locker room? And I was like, all right. Now, Simon, Nate, the custodian's locker room was a room that nobody, no student had ever been in. And it was like down by the gym. And, you know, there's like smells of like smoking and stuff coming out of there. Nobody had ever been in that room. So I read the announcements. I go down there and I knock on the door. He opens it. And there was like a card table there and lockers and stuff. Very interesting looking room. Smelled like smoke, magazines everywhere. And so I take off the gorilla outfit and I zip him up and I'm asking him questions like, Mr. Evans, what are you going to do with this? And, you know, Mr. Fitz, listen, you know what a gentleman's agreement is? I'm like, yeah, of course. You know, he said, listen, we're going to shake hands on this. I don't want you to tell anyone about this. Not your best friend, not your girlfriend, nor the students. This is our little secret that I'm borrowing this outfit from you today. And then he looked at me very sternly. He's like, do I have your word? And I was like, well, yeah, you know, and this is the guy, by the way, that's giving out detentions. And so you want to be on his good side. So zip him up. He goes running out. I'm in my underwear, by the way, sitting in the custodian's locker room now. And custodians are coming in and out. He told them, by the way. But I'm sitting there like in, you know, like I don't know. I don't think I'm wearing tighty whities at that point. But I think I'm you know, graduated to boxers. So
you're in a closet?
Well,
in your underwear?
A custodian's locker room.
He's in the janitor's closet in his tighty whities. A small child.
And there's people walking in, grown-ups walking in.
Some of the custodians came in and out, but they...
In a school...
You see where I'm going with this.
In a school that has a vice principal solely dedicated to discipline. Which, I don't know, Nate, did your high school have a guy whose entire job involved it? My high school did not have...
No, we did not have no. Those things.
What's going on in this school?
Where was the school?
Summit, New Jersey. So,
New
but
Jersey.
I'm like, I'm just kind of happy that I'm not in class right now, right?
No, so, you're in your underwear in the custodian's class.
Yeah. So, I mean, right there, you know, that could have been, you know, just a practical joke on me, but this is going to get way better. So he's gone not for 10 minutes. It's definitely 20 minutes, maybe even a little bit longer. And then he comes flying in the door and he's laughing to himself and he's sweating and he's out of breath and he's just dying of laughter. I'm like, oh my God, you know, Mr. Evans, what did you do?
Mr. Fitz, listen, thank you for letting me borrow this outfit and here's your pass to go back to class.
And I'm like, well, what did you do?
No, just, you know, that's my little secret.
So I unzip him, I zip it back up and I leave and I have no idea what he had done, but he seemed to be happy, thrilled with it. I'm just laughing. So I go back to class and then the bell rings to end that class and I go out into the hallway and now I've got my mask on. So like nobody knows who I am, but in the hallway, I noticed that I was getting a lot of attention. People are pointing at me and go, oh my God, dude, that was incredible. There's like high fives being given to me. Like there's something had happened and I don't know what had happened. So I piece it together. I ask a couple people what had happened. And Mr. Evans had gone out dressed as me in this gorilla outfit and ransacked the school. So he had run into like all the classrooms, you know, go, woo, woo, you know, like making monkey noises. He was knocking papers off people's desks. He picked up one of the teachers and like ran around the classroom. You know, he's grabbing people, picking them up, and he went into the office and just like, you know, it's just like a complete, you know, just mayhem around the school. Like he went into every single classroom. And ransacked it, and nobody knew who it was, and now everybody thinks it was me. And I'm an upstanding citizen in the school. You know, I was the vice president of the student council.
But I imagine this elevated you; it didn't undermine you.
Yeah. Well, so I thought, well, yeah, maybe this is good, and you know, and then you know, people eventually knew who, you know, that was me under the mask. So this goes on, and then we get to lunchtime. And I'm getting my lunch, and I got like a tray full of food, and I come out, and let me just back this up a little bit. So Mr. Evans, again, a friend of the family, and I was not getting detentions. I was not getting caught for things. I was definitely doing some, you know, skipping classes and all that. But I used to like kind of rib Mr. Evans that he was never going to get me in his detention class. I'm going to get you one day, you know, stuff like that. And so I come out, I got my tray of food, and I come out of the food area in the cafeteria. And there's a guy there who's like really big football player. We're going to call him Dave Mumfries, big, scary football player guy. And so Mr. George is sitting next to Dave Mumfries at the football table. And I'm positive that he put Dave Mumfries up to this. Come out. And all of a sudden he's like, hey, Mr. Evans, man, this guy ran into our classroom, you know, ransacked the classroom and stuff. And then Mr. Evans looked at me and he's like, Mr. Fitz, is that true? And all the entire cafeteria just goes silent. And then you hear the ooh, you know, like that somebody's about to get in trouble. So he in front of the entire cafeteria, he lays into me. Mr. Fitz, Halloween dress-up day is not a day to misbehave. It is a day for fun. It is not an excuse to act like an asshole. And the whole, I was sitting there like with this like look on my face, like, oh my God. So he had thought this through and he was just fucking with me and he knew that I was going to be blamed for this. So like he lays into me for a couple minutes in front of everybody in the cafeteria. Very unlike me. I was not getting yelled at a lot in high school. And just absolutely goes off of me. Mr. Fitz, I will see you in detention for the next 2 weeks. So like, oh my God, he's got me. So I had promised him that I wouldn't say anything. And I felt like if I'd said, hey, well, everybody, that, you know, that was Mr. Evans, not me. First of all, like, nobody would have believed me. But second of all, that would have broken this, you know, the gentleman's agreement that I had.
It was the perfect crime.
It was absolutely amazing. I mean, I love a good practical joke. If somebody gets me, all the power to them. So I eat my lunch. I took my lumps. And there was some street cred, by the way. Like some of my detention, you know, friends were like, hey, man, Fitz, we'll see you in detention after school. They were kind of psyched. So I go to class, and then I get called down to his office. The next, you know, class. And I go down there and he's in his office there and hey, come on in, close the door. And he just is laughing his ass off. And he goes, Mr. Fitz, I got you. unbelievable. And you know what? I did not tell anyone for a long time. I kind of lived in fear of it. And I respected his move. You know, I've been declaring that he was never going to get me in detention. I mean, not going to get in trouble. I'm too good. I get away with everything. And he totally fucking got me. It was great.
That's an incredible story.
Yeah. Yeah. So now I open it up to questions. Yeah.
Look, obviously, this guy Evans is a total hero. I'm a little stuck, though, in a tangential part of the story, which is the other custodians walking into the closet and finding you and your tidy whities.
That's really disturbing,
man. And a grown man dressed as a gorilla.
Yeah. You can call it a locker. I'm still picturing closet. You can't get it out of my head.
It was pretty small. Yeah. But that was kind of one of the most fun parts of the story is that I got to go into that place that no one had ever been in.
No comment.
I'm a little stuck there. Yeah. I'm a little stuck there.
I mean, like, you know, you wonder things like, you know, like, you know, it's your high school and there's certain like rooms that nobody had ever been into. The custodians are always in there. They're smoking cigarettes and stuff. And it was just kind of an interesting, you know, room to have.
What did it smell like?
It smelled like cigarettes. Uh-huh. Yeah. In those days, there was a smoking section in high school.
There's a duality, if I may, in this high school, where on one hand, the place is obviously so violent that they have to have a vice principal of discipline. Yeah. And so on one hand, this place sounds just terrifying. On the other hand, it's populated by crazy people like Mr. Evans who are funny and like that. It's kind of like your camp stories where there's this menace, but also comedy. And maybe that's just the 70s thing. Maybe it's the New Jersey thing. I don't know. But that was not neither of those things could have happened at my high school, yeah. Right? Nobody was engaged in that kind of comedy, and it wasn't like a violent place.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't violent, but there was discipline. Like, you know, if you were skipping too many classes, you know, if stuff like that, you're going to get some detentions. You know, so that was his job, and I'm pretty sure that was his exact title. And it, you know, he had to be a hard ass, but this guy had a terrific sense of humor. It's not the only story that Mr. Evans is in that will be part of this podcast. There are many more, and I just kind of like that. You know, he had this sense of humor. He couldn't really let it out because, you know, if some of the people that were in detention all the time found out that he was like a funny guy, they wouldn't have the fear of getting in trouble from him.
Right.
Yeah. So that's a thought. But he retired some years later, and I missed like the opportunity. But I heard later that, you know, people had the opportunity to get up and tell stories about him. And oh my God, this would have been like, you know, the best ones. I did eventually tell my parents this. My parents loved this, you know, like they loved the story.
It would have been funny and appropriate if he had retired immediately after playing this joke on you.
Yeah.
That's an incredible story, Fitz.
Yeah, there it is.
And a tribute to a great man.
Yeah, let's give it up for Mr. Evans. Not his real name, definitely, of course, but I'm not sure, you know, we need to protect him on that one. He probably would be fine with us giving his real name, but we're just going to, you know, for purposes of just safety. And
his own safety.
Yeah, his own safety. But, yeah, got to hand it to Mr. Evans, and that is the story of Halloween dress-up day. Nate, will you play us out, please?
Does New Jersey have lots of places and schools for bad kids? If so, this song's for you. I'm sorry you have to go to bad school with all the underpaid teachers and so. I'm sorry you have to deal with it. It's no fun. Just I'm hoping you just leave it home with guns. But the light is coming soon. Maybe it'll be after the 12th grade in the month of June. Oh, sleep tight, everybody.